Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Invincible, Achieve More, Suffer Less, by Marcos Vázquez, narrated by Gary Tiedemann. Chapter 0. About Invincible. The quality of your life depends on the quality of your mind. Unfortunately, we spend little time improving our thoughts, and it is rarely taught at school. As a result, we go through life without really understanding how to use our mind. We have in our head the most sophisticated object in the world, but we barely know how it works. Most people are unable to direct their mental strength toward the goals they truly desire. They get distracted and frustrated. They can't resist temptation or persevere in the face of adversity. In the end, they quit. Luckily, our mind can be trained, and this book will show you how. You will learn how to think with clarity, how to act with determination, and how to resist with discipline. Any external change requires an internal change first. If you want to transform your body, you must start from the inside. A weak mind will never create a strong body. This book will help you use your mind to improve your body, but it goes much further. It is not a simple guide to optimize your daily habits. It is also a guide to a good life. The tools you will develop will help you achieve any goal. Life is always easier with clarity, determination, and discipline. To adopt a more productive perspective on life, you will stand on the shoulders of giants, especially the Stoic philosophers. You will travel to the cradle of philosophy and surround yourself with the best thinkers of that era. You will learn directly from Seneca, Epictetus, and Marcus Aurelius. You will absorb their strategies to combat chaos and create mental order. Our world is very different from theirs, but human nature remains the same. We face the same challenges: fear, desire, anger, uncertainty, distraction, anxiety, poor discipline. Stoic philosophy has taught millions of people how to deal successfully with all these issues. It has influenced great historical figures and renowned thinkers. In recent decades, Stoicism has experienced a new golden age, spreading like wildfire among elite athletes, Navy SEALs, presidents, and entrepreneurs. On the other hand, science has made great strides in recent years. We have learned new psychological strategies to simplify change and improve our mental game. This book adopts many of these proven tools and applies them in a practical way. The combination of classical philosophy and modern psychology will improve all areas of your life. So, what does it mean to be invincible? It means to have more clarity and less fear, more purpose and less inertia, more focus and less distraction, more rational response and less emotional reaction, more gratitude and less resentment, more determination to change what you can, and less anxiety about what is beyond your control, more responsibility, and less regret. In short, this book will help you achieve more and suffer less. Your philosophy of life. The happiness of your life depends on the quality of your thoughts. Marcus Aurelius. Few people have a philosophy of life. The majority spend their days chasing temporary pleasures and avoiding discomfort. They are slaves of the immediate, lost in distractions to avoid the big question: is this how I want to live? A life without philosophy is a life without direction. Without an internal compass to guide our thoughts and actions, we will simply follow the standard path and join the unthinking mass. We will absorb the values and aspirations of society, and we will die without having actually lived. We should not be afraid of death, but of never beginning to live. Marcus Aurelius. Developing a personal philosophy will allow you to clarify what really matters to you. It will help you tolerate present discomfort in order to achieve meaningful goals. It will guide you in times of uncertainty and help you overcome adversity. Most people understand the importance of having a philosophy of life, but they don't know where to start. Rather than starting from scratch, I recommend using as a template a philosophy that has stood the test of time. That philosophical template is Stoicism. There are alternatives, of course. Some people are attracted by Eastern philosophies, like Buddhism. Although they share certain elements, as we will hear, Stoicism offers a more practical approach. The Stoics did not meditate for hours on mountains or monasteries. They made no vows of poverty or silence. They were people of action. They were businessmen and senators, athletes and emperors. They turned their philosophy into a mental operating system, a guide to thriving in the real world, to act rather than to contemplate. It was successfully applied by emperors like Marcus Aurelius and by slaves like Epictetus. Its principles were tested in palaces and in prisons. Having said that, remember that you are developing your own philosophy of life. Use this book as inspiration, but do your own reflection. Take what resonates with you and discard the rest. Structure and content of Invincible. Invincible has 5 major sections. In the first one, we will review the basic Stoic principles. After this global vision, we will explore the 3 basic steps for any successful change: visualizing with clarity, acting with determination, and resisting with discipline. Lastly, you will learn some of the techniques that the Stoics recommended to practice frequently, a kind of mental weaponry that you can deploy when needed. Chapter 1. Stoic Principles. You have power over your mind, not outside events. Realize this, and you will find strength. Marcus Aurelius. Stoicism is a practical philosophy, but in order to apply it, you must understand its basic concepts. That's why we start by presenting the most important Stoic ideas, which I will mention in future chapters. Although this book is aimed at improving your health, you will find out that the principles are generic. The laws of change are universal, and you can apply them in any area of your life. The good life. Philosophy is the love of wisdom. It is the art of living a good life. Epictetus. Stoicism tries to answer the central question of mankind: how to live a good life. The Stoics viewed philosophy as a guide to life, and their ultimate purpose was to achieve the so-called eudaimonia, usually translated as happiness. For simplicity, we will use this translation, although the modern vision of happiness does not faithfully represent the philosophical meaning attributed to it by the Stoics. The original concept was closer to a process of self-realization and personal flourishing. With this perspective, you would achieve eudaimonia by developing your potential, closing the gap between what you are and what you could become. Virtue shows us how to act in any situation. Tranquility is the ideal state of mind, which will help us do the right thing and prevent emotional suffering. Virtue. Virtue is that perfect good, which is the complement of a happy life, the only immortal thing that belongs to mortality. Seneca. Live a good life. If there are gods and they are just, then they will not care how devout you have been. but will welcome you based on the virtues you have lived by. If there are gods but unjust, then you should not want to worship them. If there are no gods, then you will be gone, but will have lived a noble life that will live on in the memories of your loved ones. Marcus Aurelius. Virtue is by far the main concern of the Stoics. They considered that acting with virtue was a necessary and sufficient condition to achieve the desired eudaimonia, or happiness. For virtue, they actually used the term arete, which can be translated as excellence, or a set of actions that will help you reach your best self. Striving for arete is not an original proposal of the Stoics. It represents the centerpiece of the first philosophical schools of Socrates or Plato, but Stoicism gives it a specific meaning that integrates it with the rest of the philosophy. When instructing us on how to act, the Stoics emphasized the need to live according to nature. They argued that human nature differs in two major ways from that of the rest of the animal world. We have the ability to reason and a deep social bond. For these reasons, living according to nature, or with virtue, would imply acting guided by reason and morals, understanding that we have a social responsibility to help others. The Stoics highlighted four key virtues: wisdom, courage, justice, and temperance. For temperance, they meant traits such as moderation and self-control. For short, I will refer to this virtue as discipline. We will explore each one in more detail shortly. Discussing virtue in the 21st century may seem outdated. Today, we see morality as something subjective and flexible, and some behaviors that were socially accepted a few decades ago are now considered appalling. But if we dig deeper, we see that all societies have valued similar traits. There are no cultures where parents want their children to be irrational, cowardly, cruel, or impulsive. The manifestation of each virtue varies according to the times and the culture. Things that were considered just in Seneca's time would seem deplorable to us today, but the concept of justice remains. It is ingrained in our genes. The Stoics admitted that acting with virtue is not easy, and they compared its development with sports or military training. It is a daily practice that we must perfect. Let's now explore each of the four basic virtues. 1. Wisdom. All we hear is an opinion, not a fact. All we see is a perspective, not the truth. Marcus Aurelius. Wisdom could be understood as the ability to observe reality objectively and rationally. In a noisy and confusing world, clarity is power. The Stoics warned that things are not usually what they seem at first glance, and they encouraged us to study them in depth. They did not refer only to the external events, but also to our own internal world. The inscription on the Temple of Delphi was concise but clear. Know thyself. As Seneca reminded us, it is much more important that you know yourself than to make yourself known to others. In the later section of Visualize with Clarity, we will delve into how to put this wisdom into practice. Once we achieve a clear vision of reality, the virtue of wisdom will help us choose the most appropriate action at each moment. Basically, it refers to making rational decisions, avoiding being swept away by emotional storms, as we will explain later. Wisdom is also key to tell good from evil, and to distinguish what is under our control from what is outside of it. These are two other important Stoic ideas that we will review shortly. 2. Justice. Have I done something for society? If so, I have worked to my advantage. Marcus Aurelius. It's nice to be important, but it is more important to be nice. Seneca. One of the usual misunderstandings about the Stoics is that they were cold and distant, unaffected by the plight of others. Nothing is further from the truth. In reality, they felt a deep social responsibility, and they insisted on the need to help others. When deciding how to act, we must consider the impact on society, or at least on our closest group. As Marcus Aurelius said, "What does not benefit the hive does not benefit the bee." Marcus Aurelius strove daily to build a better life for his people. While previous emperors had abused their power, degenerating into tyrants, Marcus Aurelius was always aware that his power gave him great responsibility, and he used this power to help others. That doesn't mean he liked everyone. In his Meditations, he speaks about the arrogant and foolish people with whom he had to deal day after day, but he did not let them lead him astray, nor did he allow himself to be influenced by others or beg for their approval. Helping was a moral obligation, not a means to an end. He would not deviate from virtue to gain the appreciation of his people. Finally, the Stoics clarified that justice is very different from revenge. In fact, Marcus Aurelius reminded us that the best revenge is to not act like those who try to harm us. 3. Courage. You do not gain courage when everything is going well, but when you survive difficult times and defy adversity. Epictetus. Admire those who try, even if they fail. Seneca. For the Stoics, courage was the ability to act virtuously regardless of the consequences. Courage is not the absence of fear, but doing the right thing despite fear. Courage also allows us to tolerate pain and adversity, both physically and mentally. Many people prefer not to try to improve their lives for fear of failure, but every time they fail to try, the fear grows. Courage is not about taking unnecessary risks, and as Seneca said, courage without wisdom is just a different kind of cowardice. We must understand that most of the fears that keep us away from our dreams are imaginary or exaggerated, and we will only make progress if we learn to control them. That is why, in future chapters, we will delve into different strategies to overcome these fears. 4. Discipline. No human propensity is so powerful that it cannot be overcome by discipline. Seneca. This fourth virtue is commonly called temperance or moderation, which includes self-control and willpower. For simplicity, I will combine these concepts under the term discipline. The Stoics demonstrated great discipline in the face of temptation or discouragement. They considered discipline a necessary condition for freedom. Those who can't control themselves will be controlled by others. Although Stoicism as a philosophy gives higher value to wisdom, it recognizes that wisdom without action is useless, and as Seneca himself stated, discipline is of great help to those with mediocre intellect. Discipline allows us to overcome the problems that will surely come. The road to a better version of you is full of obstacles. You will be tempted to give up many times, and at those times, discipline can save you. The Stoics thought that all obstacles could be turned into opportunities. They saw each roadblock along the way as a new possibility to practice their philosophy. Difficulties can help us grow. Facing the things we fear is the best way to develop the qualities we want. Self-knowledge, resilience, tolerance, persistence, resourcefulness. The discipline to do the right thing and persist in the face of challenges is crucial to achieving your goals, and it will be one of the key aspects of this book. What you will gain by developing the Stoic virtues. The reward for a good deed is its fulfillment. Seneca. For the Stoics, acting with virtue is its own reward. But I know this will not be enough for most people. We want to do the right thing, but we also want to get closer to our dreams. Fortunately, these two goals are not at odds. From a practical perspective, developing these virtues is also the best way to achieve many of the goals that we usually want, from an athletic body to a better job. If you strive for knowledge, wisdom, treat others well, justice, act despite fear, courage, and persist in the face of challenges, discipline, you will probably do well in life. The Stoics were aware that by following these principles, they would frequently achieve things valued by society, like fame and wealth. As we will hear, they did not reject these side effects, but they should not be our main motivation. And we can apply this same approach to anything we want to improve in our lives. Instead of obsessing over the outcome, focus on habits. Think less about the distant result and more about your immediate actions. By getting satisfaction from doing the right thing, you will improve your behavior. And in time, the results will come. Good deeds are their own reward. Tranquility. The nearer a man comes to a calm mind, the closer he is to his strength. Marcus Aurelius. Although the Stoics valued virtue much more than tranquility, they placed a lot of emphasis on maintaining an unperturbed mind, or ataraxia. In fact, they saw a clear connection between calmness and virtue. On the one hand, acting with virtue gives us tranquility. Seneca argued that there could be no serenity without a good conscience. They actually believed that chasing this state of mind directly could lead to vice. They would oppose achieving tranquility through drugs. The good life, they said, has more to do with actions than with feelings. Some people believe they will reach this state of psychological nirvana when they solve all their problems, making their inner peace dependent on the absence of external obstacles. It's a mistake. Problems are a part of life. When you solve some issues, others will emerge. The goal of life is not to eliminate all problems, but to do the right thing and maintain inner peace despite their presence. Stoicism will help you achieve this inner peace regardless of what happens out there. Marcus Aurelius saw his mind as an inner citadel, a fortress that remained protected and calm despite the battles on the other side of the walls. Ataraxia is a perfect state of mind for troubled times. The mind, unconquered by violent passions, is a citadel, for a man has no fortress more impregnable in which to find refuge and remain safe. Marcus Aurelius. On the other hand, an anxious or troubled mind will have difficulty acting in a thoughtful way, and therefore tranquility prevents us from doing the wrong thing. And what are the enemies of tranquility? Passions, which we will explore next. Passions. Men are disturbed not by the things that happen, but by their opinion of the things that happen. Epictetus. By passions, the Stoics referred to irrational or exaggerated emotions, which cloud reason and hinder virtue. It is difficult to act rationally if you are possessed by desire, fear, or anger. They saw these disproportionate emotions as pathological and considered them to be at the root of human suffering, hence the emphasis they placed on controlling them. And I say control because the Stoics did not propose to suppress these emotions, but to channel them in a productive way to minimize their detrimental effect. They knew that these emotions are often caused by innate impulses to which our body responds involuntarily. As Seneca said, we cannot avoid passions, but we can overcome them, and he used several examples that illustrate this. If we hear a loud noise, we are alarmed. and if we make a mistake in public, we blush. To quote Seneca again, no amount of wisdom will eliminate these natural reactions. Innate things can't be removed, but they can be tempered with practice. In other words, reason cannot prevent an emotion, but it can regulate it and give it a better perspective. Therefore, they did not propose to stop feeling, but to develop tools to minimize the impact of negative emotions on our actions and our well-being. We conquer the passions by becoming stronger than them, not by preventing them from appearing. That being said, you will notice with practice that negative emotions tend to decrease in intensity and frequency. On the other hand, the Stoics understood the adaptive role of emotions. They did not think that fear itself was bad, as it protects us from doing dangerous things. They did not believe that the desire for food was harmful, since a baby without hunger would die. But they warned that the automatic reactions caused by these emotions can be damaging. If we don't control fear, we become paralyzed by it and don't pursue our dreams. If we don't control the desire for food, we will damage our health. The Stoics proposed that we reflect on the suitability of each emotion and its intensity before acting. This pause between the emotion and the response can be life-changing. They called these passions pathy, and the mental state free from them, apatheia. This concept was translated into English as apathy, with obvious negative connotations. This has led many people to believe that Stoics are indifferent to the external world, or that they lack enthusiasm. This is not true. The Stoics were deeply involved in society. Their clarity of mind and discipline often made them successful by conventional metrics, such as money or fame. On the other hand, Stoicism urges us to maintain a state of mind where positive emotions, such as affection towards others and gratitude for life, predominate. Marcus Aurelius spoke of being free of passion and yet full of love. In the section Visualize with Clarity, we will review the main passions or emotions that we must tame, and you will learn how not to be a slave to them. The Stoics also reminded us that between the external event and the internal emotion, there is a belief. It is this belief that determines our initial interpretation of that event, good or bad. By changing our belief, we change our emotion. It is time to introduce the dichotomy of control. The dichotomy of control. In life, our first job is this: to divide and distinguish things into two categories, externals I cannot control, and the choices I make with regard to them I do control. Epictetus. The wise man is concerned with the intention of his actions, not with their results. Our initial action is under our control, but fate determines its end. Seneca. The Handbook of Epictetus begins by explaining the so-called dichotomy of control, which distinguishes between things we can control and things we cannot. This is a basic principle of Stoicism, of great practical value. Making our well-being depend on things beyond our control is one of the main causes of dissatisfaction. And what is under our control, according to Epictetus? Only our perceptions and our actions. So what is out of our control? Everything else. Epictetus explicitly mentions items such as our body, our property, and our reputation. We should therefore not depend on any of these elements for our happiness. Does this mean we have no control over our body or our health? Yes and no. We have partial control, and we decide, for example, what we eat and how much we exercise, but we will never be completely safe from accidents or disease. Some modern authors propose the concept of trichotomy of control, distinguishing between what is totally within our control, partially within our control, and totally outside of our control. But if we go deeper into what is partially within our control, such as our health, we observe that it opens again in two. We can control our actions or effort, but not the outcome. One of the most important lessons of Stoicism is to focus our energy and effort on what depends on us. Worrying about things that are not under our control only creates anxiety and frustration. To clarify this lesson, we will use Cicero's analogy of an archer. If an archer wants to hit a target with his arrow, he has many elements under his control. He decides, for example, how many hours he practices archery, which bow he uses, and, when the time comes, how far he pulls the bowstring and how he aims. But once the arrow leaves his bow, there is nothing else he can do. Whether the arrow hits its target is not up to him. A gust of wind or a sudden movement of the target will alter the result, but it is not something that should worry the archer, because they are elements beyond his control. Applied to any professional environment, it is a powerful mental tool, especially in areas where rejection and failure are experienced on a daily basis. An athlete who loses his mind after every defeat will not get very far. He must learn to see the result as information, which will help him to better prepare for the next competition. A salesperson who gets frustrated with every no will have to look for a different job. Instead, he must objectively analyze every interaction with potential clients, noticing what worked and what didn't. It is inevitable to feel some disappointment after losing a game or being rejected in a sale, but applying the Stoic mindset will help you recover faster. This approach will turn self-pity into self-improvement, using loss as a powerful tool. In short, the Stoics urged us to focus our thoughts and our efforts on what we can control, ignoring everything else. This way, we will maximize the probability of achieving the desired result, avoiding unnecessary suffering in the process. Once we know the result, we will accept it with equanimity. It is time to introduce the next Stoic concept, amor fati. Amor fati. Don't seek to have events happen as you wish, but wish them to happen as they do happen, and all will be well with you. Epictetus. It is in no man's power to have whatever he wants, but he has it in his power not to wish for what he hasn't got, and cheerfully make the most of the things that do come his way. Seneca. Although the term amor fati was coined long after the early Stoics, it perfectly reflects their teaching to not just accept fate, but to come to appreciate it. We cannot change what happened, but we can change how we perceive it. We can think, for example, that something good will come out of it. Zeno himself, founder of Stoicism, is a good example. He was a merchant until his ship, carrying precious cargo, suffered a terrible accident on one of his voyages. He lost everything he had, and almost his own life. As a result of this shipwreck, he reached the shores of Greece and later headed to Athens, where he learned philosophy and created his own school. This was for him the most important thing he ever achieved, and it would have been impossible without the shipwreck that ruined him. I made a prosperous voyage when I suffered shipwreck. Zeno. To explain how to think about our destiny, the Stoics used the analogy of a dog tied to a cart. The cart is being pulled by animals much stronger than it, so the dog only has two options. One, trot alongside the cart and take advantage of the length of its leash to explore everything in its path. Two, resist the movement of the cart by digging its paws into the ground. In both cases, the dog will reach the same destination, but the experience of the journey will be very different. If he chooses to walk along, he will spend a pleasant and quiet time. If the dog resists, he will suffer pain and frustration. Fate leads the willing and drags along the reluctant. Seneca. Some people interpret this stoic acceptance of destiny as passive resignation, but it would be a mistake to see it that way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.